Hey guys, we are firmly in the middle of the playoffs and it is a fantastic time to be watching the NBA. Harman, my co-host, you got to tell me, in the middle of the chaos of the playoffs, what's actually catching your attention?
Well, rhymed, bro. Chaos of the playoffs. I like it. Since you've asked, Rohan, I'm definitely intrigued by a certain team in the West, somewhere around the Bay Area, obviously. You know my keen interest in the Warriors, but let me just get to it. First of all, welcome everyone to the NBA India Weekly Show, brought to you by JBL. I'm your co-host, Harman Singha, and joining me as always is my friend, fellow hoophead, also a crazy cool footballer, international traveler, fashion photographer, Bollywood celebrity in the making, Rohit Shrestha.
Too much, but thank you.
I'm your hype man.
As always, the conference semis, Harman, they've definitely been a battle. I think that would be an understatement. Watching these games is giving me anxiety.
Absolutely.
Just saying. So let's get right to it.
All right.
So we begin in the East, and the top seed in the East, the Miami Heat. You know, Harman, when we spoke last week about the series, things were not looking very good for the Sixers. You're completely wearing their t-shirt. And I have to be very honest with you. I was watching the Phoenix game and I passed out at the end of the Phoenix game.
The Sixers are back, man. Game 4 was huge and I think it was a big relief for Philadelphia. The man that they traded from Brooklyn Nets, the man who was the face of the Houston Rockets for so long, who's come so close to reaching the NBA Finals as a Rocket, he finally showed up. I mean, just look at how the things opened for the shooters in Game 3 and 4. Philly have shot at a scorching 48.5% from 3 in both the games, and James Harden just took over the fourth quarter, reminded us of how great he actually is. It's a stark contrast from Miami, who now in the low 20s with their three-point shooting. Clearly, the 76ers have raised the intensity on defense as well.
I mean, so James Harden, obviously he had the best game of his series. I'm reading that he scored 31 points, dishing 9 assists, and most importantly, turning up clutch in the moments of the fourth quarter.
Absolutely.
But that's why they've got him, right? James Harden is a superstar.
Yeah.
He's an MVP of the league. So, I think that's the only way the Sixers reach the promised land. It's been a while for them,
yes.
But that's James Harden's got to perform, right? He's the man there now, other than obviously Joel Embiid leading that entire team.
Yeah.
But James Harden's got to be that option as well.
And speaking of Embiid, he came out swinging in the first quarter, you know, set the tone early, finished with 24 points and 11 rebounds. As for the Heat, Jimmy Butler had 40 points and at times it felt like he was just trying to will the Heat to win. But he and Bam Adebayo, who had 21 points, were the only ones who had anything to contribute for the Miami team. So I would say stay tuned for the Game 5, guys, because this is going to be huge. The series will, you know, pretty much be decided in this Game 5, which way it's going, because whosoever has the advantage, I think, will eventually move ahead.
Okay, sticking with the East in a game I did not fall asleep for. The Milwaukee Bucks beat the Boston Celtics 103-101 to take the series lead,
yes.
2-1. My God, this game was tough. It was a tough game to watch. It was so gnarly at the end of it. I can't even begin to tell you. Giannis took it to them. That's all I can say.
Yeah.
This series is as exciting as we thought it was going to be. The Bucks barely escaped this game. That's what I would say, because Al Horford did get that tip in, but it was just after the buzzer. And it was a two-point game. I mean, the Bucks got out of it, but I think it's a tough one. I don't know when Middleton's going to be back, but I think, for the Bucks and the Celtics, for this series, it's just a tough series. It probably is the most likely to go to 7 games, in my opinion.
Yeah, and you know, there was so much last-minute drama. Giannis just going berserk. Playoff defense by Giannis Antetokounmpo. And I just love watching these two teams. It feels like a conference finals. The tension, the atmosphere, the intensity of the basketball play itself. It's just massive. I love watching these two teams.
Yeah, I mean, absolute treat, man. This is like, for me, old school NBA defense first playoff basketball. I love it. I thought the first couple of games they managed to counter Giannis really well. And then Giannis has just decided to go, like, for Mario getting a mushroom and then it's becoming bigger. He's like, Giannis dropped 42 points and he made the go-ahead bucket with 44 seconds to go. Then the Celtics got two free throws with 4.3 seconds to go as Marcus Smart got fouled. But he made that free throw, intentionally missed the next one to grab the rebound. Then Smart, Robert Williams and Al Horford all missed attempts at the rim before Horford finally made the layup. And then?
And that layup obviously did not count because it was made after the buzzer. I mean, just, you can't write an ending. It's like, for me as a script writer, it's the perfect ending to a game.
The Celtics bench thought they won, by the way. They were already celebrating. Oh, it was heartbreaking. Jaylen Brown showed up for the Celtics. He had 27 points, 12 rebounds. Al Horford, who was having a very good series as well, finished with 22 points, 15 rebounds. Of course, I mentioned Jason Tatum earlier. He went 4-for-19 from the field. I think he finished with 10 points that.
I mean, it's safe to say that this series is not for the faint-hearted. So make sure you have the most relaxing day before you get into these games. I think we both agree that this is going to a Game 7. I mean, there's no other way, right? Well, the Golden State Warriors, you see, just see the change in my tonality and my voice. The Golden State Warriors beat the Memphis Grizzlies 142 to 112 and took the series lead at home. After a couple of tightly fought, like nerve-wracking games, the Warriors blew the series wide open with a commanding win over the Grizzlies in Game 3. Steph Curry led the Warriors with 30 points. And I just want to tell you, I came back from a night shoot at 7 in the morning. Came back, the game started, I watched the entire game. I hadn't slept for like 36 hours, but it didn't matter because Steph Curry was a different version of Steph Curry, not shooting threes. Instead, he was just taking the entire action right to the rim. And that was, I think, the difference in the way the Warriors played. They did not rely on their perimeter shooting at all. They made some very interesting changes. Everybody was looking to attack in the paint, including Jordan Poole. And we got to speak about Ja Morant. 34 points, but he got little support from the rest of the team. The Warriors' defense also looked a lot more in form in this game. With Draymond Green leading this charge, the Warriors have used Wiggins and Kuminga to guard the perimeter with athletic wings. The focus was, let Ja do his thing because it's virtually impossible to defend Ja. That is what Draymond Green himself said, who's one of the best defenders in the league, right? So he said, you can't stop Ja, but our plan was to just make sure everybody else that we can stop, we stop.
Yeah, I mean, it also helps when you got Jordan Poole playing these roles from the bench. I mean, it's ridiculous. Like, he's like, 27-30 regularly off the bench. I don't even think he should be on the bench anymore. I don't even know. It's a great team. There's a great. They move the ball so well, man. And it's like watching the Warriors of old, especially this game, where everybody's just hitting threes. Klay was just outstanding.
We have to talk about Klay, man. The Klay Thompson that we're used to seeing in our lives seemed to come to the party in Game 3, played extremely well, shot at a high percentage, was shooting threes, was shooting deep twos, even moving all the way, cutting and getting the ball, laying it up. The Grizzlies will definitely make some adjustments, but I think the most important for them will be forcing the Warriors into tougher shots. The Phoenix Suns took on the Dallas Mavericks and there's some interesting things going on. Mavericks have won the last two games and leveled the series 2-2. Game 4, they beat the Phoenix 111-101. I mean, Game 5 of the Suns and Mavs is another one to look forward to, as intense as the Milwaukee and Boston series has turned out to be. The big story for me, Rohan, was Dorian Finney-Smith, who made 8 out of 12 as the Mavs collectively shot 45.5% on their threes, making 20 of them.
They held them. I mean, I watched this game and the Suns kind of look out of sorts in both the games, actually, in Dallas. I think Dallas have kind of figured some things out.
Yeah.
So, funnily enough, you know, Arman Luka shot 9 of 25 from the field. He still finished with 26 points and he dished out 11 assists as well.
Yeah.
But he was being defended by Campaign in the third and the fourth quarter. And he made sure that everybody knew that Campaign was smaller than him. Luka being Luka, got in his face a couple of times. honestly, the Suns just look completely out of sorts, especially with the Mavs picking their game up so well now.
Yeah.
The team looks more complete. Yeah, and you're right about Smith, man. Dorian Finney-Smith, he's a fantastic defender, but if he's going to shoot 8 threes in a game at that level of percentage, I mean, what chance do you have? I think the Mavs outshot. I don't even know how many threes they hit. I think like above
20. Yeah, 20.
Yeah, and the Suns were like 8 or 9, so that difference was huge in itself.
Yeah, and despite 35 points by Devin Booker, they just couldn't match the Mavs, you know. Every time the Suns were closing the gap, it just seemed like the Mavs had the perfect answer for them. And there was an avalanche of threes that just increased the lead. The Mavs were very effective in hounding the Suns as well, forcing 17 turnovers from a team that boasts to have the best point guard in the league. So that's an interesting story that might develop as we go.
I mean, just by looking at them and what they've done in the regular season as well as being the finalists last season, they have enough caliber to beat the Mavs. But, you know, there's always something called Luka magic, and that guy is magic. So, I don't know. It's always a tough one to say this, especially now that it's 2-2.
And let's ask our fans over there, do you genuinely believe that Luka magic is real? And do you think the Mavs can take the Suns to a Game 7?
That's it from us this week. Guys, if you have any predictions, thoughts, opinions, do share them with us. And we'll probably have our conference finalists when we're back next week. Make sure you catch the NBA playoffs live on Sports 18, MTV, VH1, Voot, and JioTV. So many options for you guys. Too many.
And finally, like, share, subscribe, retweet, or leave a comment. We want to hear from you guys. Please tag us in any amazing NBA trivia, fact, or video that you come across. And like Rohan always likes to say, we're still learning. Please feel free to send in your suggestions.